Hey there, today I'm going to do something a little bit old school and I'm going to be reviewing an exam from 1866. So this is an arithmetic exam and it's from 152 years ago if my arithmetic is any good. Now this is called the Regents Questions and I believe it's from an exam from the state of New York. The Regents exams that are designed for, I think, graduating high school students to be able to graduate and get their diploma. So to be able to prove, you know, everything that you've sort of learned during your courses there. I believe the Regents exams still sort of exist today in some form, but it's not the same as it was back then. This is an arithmetic exam, and I think it's since been replaced by things like geometry, algebra, calculus, and many other different disciplines. So regardless of what form the Regents exams look like these days, we're going to have a look through these very old questions and just see what life was like back then for a budding mathematician. I'm going to go out on a hunch and assume that there are no calculators involved here, so you're going to have to be doing all this by hand. And it kind of makes sense that they want to train you up to be good at arithmetic, to be good at things like bookkeeping or just general day-to-day sums. Now, I got these questions from a book which was published in 1880. It's publicly available online and I'll link to it. And it's just a database of all these past problems going all the way back to the start. So follow along with that if you would like to. And in my next video, which will be uploaded shortly after this one, I will actually work through in detail one of the more tricky questions from this exam, because in this video, we're not going to really work them out, just have a look at what they're like. So let's get started. So here is page one. We have the Regents Questions, Arithmetic, Examination 1, November 8th, 1866. Let's go through the problems. Number one. Write in figures each of the following numbers. Add them and express in words their sum. So we've got some numbers written down in words. It would seem kind of easy to just write them down in digits, but this is an 1866 exam after all, so it's a little bit trickier than that. They've given us 56,000 and 14 thousandths. So I guess they're talking about the places after the decimal point here, so you would have like your tenths, hundredths, thousandths, and tens of thousandths digits. So the numbers are a little bit trickier. We've got 19 and 19 hundredths, 57 and 48 ten thousandths, 23,005 and 4 tenths, and 14 millionths. So a little bit tricky, but I think it's still all right. Number two, what is the difference between 3 and 8 quarters? Plus 7 and 5 eighths, and 4 plus 2 and 8 quarters. So this is a fractions problem. We've got some mixed fractions here. I think the rule is just going to be you need to add some fractions essentially, and to do that you'll need to, I guess, convert them to have a common denominator, so getting out of mixed fractions into improper ones. Question three. In multiplying by more than one figure, where is the first figure in each partial product written, and why is it so written? Now, this one seems a little bit confusing. I guess I don't really know what they're saying. As far as I can tell, they're talking about multiplying by more than one figure, and to me that means when you have, say, two numbers being multiplied together, and each number is like more than one digit in size, and you do that thing when you do it column by column, so you'd go 2 by 8, 16, carry the 1, 1 by 8, plus that, 9, and then you do like the next one, the 10, so that would be 4, and that would be 2, and then you add these up, that would be 3, 3, 6. So I think that's what they're talking about, but I guess I don't really know how to answer the question. Where is each partial product written? Are these the partial products? Are they talking about carrying the 1? Something like that. Number 4. If the divisor is 19, the quotient 37, and the remainder 11, what is the dividend? So the dividend is the number to be divided by something. So the dividend is divided by 19. The answer is 37 with a remainder of 11. So to work backwards and find what the dividend is, we'd do 19 times 37 plus 11. Number 5. what is the quotient of 65 EU, 1 PK, and 3 QT divided by 12? So these are a bunch of, I guess, units that I'm not familiar with. I did a quick Google of them, and I think it's quart, peck, and bushel. But yeah, I guess I don't really know how many of each of these is in this one, and likewise, but you'd have to convert them down to, I guess, the quart, divide it by 12, and then maybe convert it back into these types of units again. Number six, which of the fundamental operations or ground rules of arithmetic is employed in reduction descending? So initially I had no idea what reduction descending is, but I gave this one a quick Google as well, and I think it refers to when you're like going down in denomination, like so if you have dollars and you want to convert it into cents, if I had a dollar and I wanted to know how many cents was in it, I would times it by 100. So I believe this one would be multiplication. Number seven, in exchanging gold dust for cotton, by what weight would each be weighed? This one seems a bit out of my reach. I guess I don't know exactly what they're saying, but I feel like maybe they're on some old school scale and they're like needing to weigh gold dust and cotton against some standard weight. I'm not really sure. Here's one that I think we'll be able to get. What is the only even prime number? The answer to that would be 2. Number 9, how many weeks in this many minutes? About 8 million. I think this would be a process of dividing and probably a series of long division problems. So you'd want to convert from minutes, divide it by 60 to find out how many hours there are, divide it by 24 to get how many days, divide by 7 days into weeks. So a series of division. Hope you'll sharpen up your long division skills because mine are very rusty. Number 10, to what term in division does the value of a common fraction correspond? I don't really know what the terms in division are, except that it could be like the dividend, the divisor, the quotient, the remainder or something. I'm going to have to pass on that one though. Number 11, what is the product of a fraction multiplied by its denominator? Well, if we had the fraction 1/2 and multiplied it by 2, you just end up with 1, or you just end up with whatever you started with on the top, so that would be ending up with the numerator. Number 12, what is the rule for the multiplication of decimals? Now, this one hasn't been outdated. This rule still applies. The rule is that the decimal point is placed in the product so that the number of decimal places in the product is the sum of decimal places in what you're multiplying together. So, for example, if you're multiplying a number with 2 decimal places by a number with 1 decimal place, your answer will have to have 3 decimal places in it. That's still something that I remember doing in school. Number 13, how is a common fraction reduced to a decimal? I guess to convert a fraction to a decimal, what you're doing is you're dividing the numerator by the denominator, so I guess that's all you can do, maybe do it by long division. Number 14, what is ratio and how may it be expressed? This one's a little difficult to put into words, but I guess I would say that a ratio is the number of times one value is like contained within the other. 15, if this amount of coal costs this amount of dollars, what will this amount of coal cost? So I think this is another case of like converting this whole value into like the lowest denominator, so like pounds, is that? I don't know. And then working out how much each pound costs, then converting this one into pounds too and working out its total cost. Number 16, find the cost of the several articles and the amount of the following bill. This one is a little bit awkward. I think it may have got something to do with rent or something. So we've got A.P. Jewett paying to Dr. Samuel Palmer for some amount feet of board at some amount per m. So I guess this is literally square feet of space or that you're boarding. And this is either the cost per meter, like square meter per month. I'm not sure. I guess in essence, you'd have to understand the language here and what's common in terms of these types of things. But it probably comes down to just adding up these different articles. 17, what is the length of the side of a cubical box which contains 389,017 solid inches? Excuse me, but this one seems pretty difficult to do without a calculator, like so much more than the other ones. I guess doing a cube root without a calculator is not something that I am well versed in, but you would have to do it through either like long division type sums or through some sort of estimation and checking method. Number 18, what is the present worth of the following note discounted at a bank and when will it become due? So we've got a nice little letter here. 90 days from date for value received, I promise to pay to the order of John Smith $100 at the Albany City National Bank, John Brown. Forgive me if I'm mistaken, this one seems to just be asking how much it's worth, and it seems to be $100 paid 90 days from the date, and this is the date here. So maybe this is some basic bookkeeping type skills, although I would say these types of word problems kind of do age this exam a little. You really wouldn't see something written in the same way today. Something that has not aged itself though, in fact has aged pretty well, is things like this, where it's just using the numbers and the most basic sentences. Maybe this one here, involve 5/8 to the 7th power. That's pretty much the same as what you'd see today, except maybe the word involve would be changed to find 5/8 or like solve 5/8, something like that. For this question though, it seems easy in essence. You just need to take 5/8 times it by itself 7 times. Although when you do it, it turns out to get a little bit difficult on the algebra. For example, I worked out what 5/8 to the 6th power would be. So this would represent what you're going to have to do in your final sum to get the 7th power. But to the 6th power, you're already dealing with fraction 15625 over 262144. So already you're getting quite high and you still need to take this and times it again by 5/8. So I don't think that is necessarily like a walk in the park, because even though you know what to do, you do have to actually go into the details every time, and it would be a little bit of time to solve it. Number 20, what is the square root of 0.004304672 1? Now this question has me a little bit shook, because just like the cube root question on the previous page, this seems sort of absurd to be asking, I think, without the calculator, but actually I guess it can be done. And it's interesting to me to actually learn more about how they would have done this. So in the next video, which I'm going to upload shortly after this one, I'll take this problem here and we'll see if we can solve it by hand. Maybe we'll have a little bit of fun there. But I'm really interested to actually work through how you would do that without the luxury of the calculator. Maybe I'm too used to the luxury. Number 21, we have an amount of sugar at a certain price. It looks like it's like lost 12% in price, so how much was the whole cost? For something like this, I guess in essence it's the same as what we still do these days. If you want to find out how much it was worth before it depreciated, you would take the total amount now, divide it by 0.88, and that would tell you how much it was worth to start with. Number 22, a person owned 5/8 of a mine and sold 8/4 of his interest for this amount. What was the value of the entire mine? I feel like this would have made sense to me if he was selling some sensible portion of his share of the mine, but it seems like he's selling, well, 2 of his share. So I don't know how you can actually sell more than what you have. That's what it seems like to me. I guess this must be like a multiplication of fractions somewhere, but the wording is so awkward, I'd probably be a little bit tricked here. Nearly at the end, number 23, it's talking about at a certain time, at a certain longitude, use that to work out what time it will be at a different longitude. This one actually seems interesting to me, because I guess we take for granted like time zones and longitude and I guess the relationship between them. But if you really do think about it, every hour of time zone difference would actually correspond to a change of 15 degrees in the longitude. So I guess you can use that fact to work out here how the time is changing. And finally, another question using several different units here, which are not metric, which is, I mean, that's why it's hard to start with. I guess converting it down into some unit that you choose and then dividing this price by that number. I don't know what potash is, but okay. I guess overall this exam spooks me a little because I've gone through a lot of mathematics, but this paper is not really about mathematics. It's arithmetic. It's what it says. It's really testing your long division, your multiplication, your basic skills like that, which can actually fall out of practice the further you go into maths. It's sort of funny to talk with my friends about how bad we are sometimes at arithmetic, considering our qualifications and some of these really high level ideas. You know, if we like go out to dinner together, it will take several of us to just work out how to split the bill. It's not like these are the skills that you actually really practice every day the further you go. It gets more and more abstract from here. But it makes sense. This is 1866, and I guess even when I was in high school, teachers in hindsight sort of lied to us and said, you've got to learn these skills because you're not going to just have a calculator in your pocket everywhere you go. It turned out to be sort of true with smartphones and everything, but back in 1866, I guess that sentiment actually did ring true, that you didn't have a calculator in your pocket. I guess it raises the question of nowadays, is arithmetic important? Like, eventually some of these skills have been phased out, even in the Regents exam since this first one. And it's kind of my opinion that arithmetic is less and less important to learn and to know and to have so much practice in, because whilst I think it's still valuable to know the foundations of what you're doing and to call yourself a mathematician without understanding how to do long division, it's a little bit strange, I admit, but also there's so much to learn and so much to do that really we only have time to focus on doing the important things that are new. But in having said that, probably around the world there are still some exams like this. Some countries, I think, would focus more on making sure that someone who wants to call themselves a mathematician can do these like square roots by hand. I never had to prove that, but I'm sure somewhere in the world this is still the kind of thing you're having to prove. And I guess I'm not the judge of whether that's good or bad or not, but respect to the people that could solve all of this exam, no worries, because it's already what they've been practicing. I'd like to thank Brilliant.org for sponsoring today's video. On Brilliant.org, you can sharpen your own competitiveness when taking exams, hopefully a little bit different from the exam we looked at today. But on Brilliant, they do have courses covering mathematical fundamentals, as well as some competitive exams such as the AMC. They have a course on how to ace the AMC, and they cover all sorts of ideas around that, including exam techniques and how to best eliminate multiple choice questions. If you're interested to learn more about this, then you can go to brilliant.org/tibees and sign up for free. Also, the first 200 people who follow that link can get 20% off an annual premium subscription. Thanks to Brilliant, and I would recommend them as a place where you can take quizzes and really test your knowledge rather than just sort of passively trying to learn and read about ideas. The interactive nature of this site makes it a really good learning resource.